Good evening, one and all. Respected Vice Chancellor, respected Director, Director General of Shipping, Registrar, Director of IMU Chennai Campus, members of the faculty, non-teaching staff, and dear students. A hearty welcome to all of you to the third lecture in the monthly Maritime Lecture Series introduced by the Vice Chancellor since January 2015. This lecture was originally scheduled to be held in the last week of March 2015. But the Director General of Shipping, Shri Deepak Shetty, could not make it due to his official preoccupation. We are very happy and proud to have him in our midst today, and we will be delivering his keynote address on maritime security and piracy. A word or two about our distinguished chief guest. Shri Deepak Shetty is a direct recruit member of the 1980 batch of the Indian Revenue Service, Customs and Central Excise, holding the rank of Chief Commissioner. He is presently officiating as the Director General of Shipping since January 2015. He was earlier Additional Director General of Shipping from 26/4/2011 to 31/December 2014. Shri Deepak Shetty is the recipient of several official decorations, including the Presidential Award for Specially Distinguished Record of Service bestowed on him on the Republic Day 2002. He underwent special training at Kuala Lumpur and Singapore in international anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financing by the Asia-Pacific Group on Money Laundering. He has also attended as the official representative of the Ministry of Shipping, Government of India, the various plenary sessions of the Contact Group on Piracy off the Coast of Somalia, held at New York, Djibouti, and Dubai since December 2012. As such, he is eminently suited to deliver today's lecture. I now request the Vice Chancellor, Shri K. Ashokwardhan Shetty, to deliver the welcome address.
Respected Director General of Shipping, Shri Deepak Shetty, Registrar Shri Mohan, Director IM Chennai Campus Shri Rajiv Prakash, members of the faculty, non-teaching staff, and dear students. While lectures, classroom lectures, group discussions, industrial visits, assignments, projects are all important and are a part of your curriculum, there is no substitute for guest lectures, for listening to eminent persons, personalities in the field of maritime sector, who can share their experiences with you and who can broaden your mental horizons. I remember the days when I was undergoing training as an IAS officer in Missouri. The faculty there were not so great. Our most vivid memories are those of the guest lecturers who came from a wide spectrum of activities, ranging from film stars to journalists to politicians to administrators to scientists and whatnot. And what these people taught us or spoke to us in the course of those guest lectures is what I still remember. So while it's important for you to listen to your teachers and take part in the various classroom activities, it is equally important to listen to the experiences of people from diverse fields. It is with this intention that the monthly Maritime Lecture Series has been started from January 2015 onwards. We began with Shri L.R. Chari, Executive Director of Shipping Corporation of India. Then Shri VT, Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi, former Secretary of Shipping and currently Chairman of the National Shipping Board, addressed you in February. Now the Director General of Shipping, Mr. Deepak Shetty, will be talking on maritime security and piracy. I'm sure many of you are worried about your prospects after you finish your courses, but you must remember that shipping as an industry is a highly volatile industry with periodic booms and busts. The industry has seen about 20 such booms and busts in the last 200 years, and this must be taken as a given. You are lucky if you are passing out in a time of boom. You are unlucky if you are passing out in a time of bust. The shipping industry's fates are very closely aligned to the state of the global economy. And as you know, there was a boom between 2004 and 2009. The subprime lending crisis in the US triggered off a global economic recession, followed by a global economic slowdown. And the shipping industry also collapsed along with it. Prices of ships came down drastically. Shipping freight charges came down drastically. And naturally, job opportunities during these last 5 years have been bad. But all indications are that the industry is on an upswing again. And I hope that by the time you pass out, things will be much better. I'm sure all of you have a number of questions to ask the Director General of Shipping at the end of his lecture. And I request you to make full use of this opportunity. If anybody has any other grievances relating to anything, you may again make use of this opportunity and address the Director General of Shipping. Now, coming to Shri Deepak Shetty, I would just like to add a couple of words to the introduction that Dr. Shekhar has already given. He's a very fine officer and an equally fine gentleman, and regarded as one of the best officers in the Indian Customs and Central Excise Service that the country has produced so far. I think he's only the second non-IAS officer to be appointed as the Director General of Shipping. The first was an Indian Railway Traffic Officer way back in the 1970s. If you think of it, Customs and Central Excise Service has a lot of interaction, a lot of interface with shipping as well as ports. And it's only proper that a customs officer should officiate either as a DG Shipping or as Additional Director of Shipping. And Shri Deepak Shetty has done a long stint as Additional Director of Director General of Shipping for about 3 years. And now he is the Director General of Shipping from January onwards. As I said, he's a very fine officer and an equally fine gentleman, and he has left a mark in every post that he has held. It's not for nothing that he has won the President's Award for Distinguished Service, and I have great pleasure in welcoming Shri Deepak Shetty to deliver his address. I also welcome all of you who have come for this lecture, and I hope you will find it useful and interesting. Thank you.
The Vice Chancellor will felicitate the chief guest with a bouquet and a ponnade. I call upon Shri Deepak Shetty to deliver the keynote address.
Respected Dr. K. Ashokwardhan Shetty, Vice Chancellor, Mr. Mohan, Registrar, Mr. Rajiv Prakash, the Director of the IMU Chennai Campus, members of the faculty, the non-teaching staff, cadets. I see my colleague, the Principal Director of the Mercantile Marine Department of Chennai, and distinguished invitees. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm indeed delighted to be here amidst all of you this afternoon. It's a matter of honor and privilege to be here. At the outset, may I extend my earnest gratitude to the IMU in general and in particular to the Vice Chancellor for this very cordial invite extended to me. He has borne with me for the last month and a half. I've had, on two occasions, had to get this deferred. My apologies for that. That's primarily because of the various preoccupations and the entire commitments that suddenly come about. But be that as it may, as I said, I'm extremely happy to be here. And what is singularly encouraging is the large sprinkling of cadets and trainees who represent the future of the maritime sector of the country. It is also a matter of gratitude that I'm probably the third invitee in this maritime lecture series. And if I'm not mistaken, this is a monthly event that you organize. It is just as well, as your Vice Chancellor indicated to you, you know, there is more than the classroom learning. There is something called as an experiential learning that you can get imparted with, and that is courtesy. Let's say, I wouldn't say that those who are, you know, those who have been in the industry, but essentially, as I said, learning is a two-way process. If I stand before you, much as I would share my experiences, but I'm sure there is an equal measure that I can get to learn by your presence, and hopefully that will happen in the course of the Q&A session to follow. You may be wondering as to why I chose this topic, the theme of the day of maritime security and piracy. This is not to instill any scaremongering amongst you, particularly the budding futuristic seafarers, but it is primarily to highlight to you a significant paradigm of the maritime sector, which often tends to, in the larger public discourse, recede in the background. Typically, if you go to most maritime sector events, be they workshop, symposium, or seminar, you'd find that the emphasis, the thrust is on how do you increase tonnage, how do you carry more cargo on your national bottoms and the like, how do you make it more marine environmentally friendly, how do you ensure that the SOLAS Convention, for instance, illustratively, you go about securing and having safer seas, cleaner oceans, etc. But seldom do you find that, and I'm subject to correction here, that there is this aspect which is there at the background, but we tend to typically forget, which is maritime security and piracy. One of the reasons which I sort of decided to come up and share my experiences is my past background from my parent organization. I belong to the Indian Revenue Service, and I've had the singular privilege of having worked in anti-smuggling assignments, which is economic law enforcement, for a number of years, almost for about two decades of my 35 years of service hitherto. I've had the privilege of having been exposed to all the nuances. I mean, I see a very generational gap between most of you here, but I'm blessed in the sense when I look back in retrospect, pretty much every nuance, and I'm saying this with utmost modesty, be it economic intelligence, information gathering, interdictions in the sea, and I'll come to that in a little while from now, investigation, prosecution, preventive detention. These are all aspects which somehow, you know, have a certain connectivity with the theme of the day. And as I said, I've been very fortunate to have had these, and particularly I recall very fondly a time when in the late 80s and the early 90s when I was in the Directorate General of Revenue Intelligence. I don't know how many of you have heard an acronym called DRI, which is the Premier Customs Anti-Smuggling Outfit. And I was fortunate to have served there for 7 years in Mumbai at a time when smuggling was at its absolute peak in the late 80s and the early 90s. And so the sheer exposure which I mean, it still gives me goosebumps when I look back in time. So when I, to coming back to the theme of the day, I'll just briefly highlight an important aspect that all of you have heard that India wishes to be a maritime power, and I would want to refrain from using the term maritime superpower. And India bids fair to be a blue water force. Some of you would have heard this term, I'm sure. Now, if that were to happen, if you wish to be aspirational, and if you wish that ambition to be nurtured and nourished, then clearly you need to ensure that your maritime frontiers are secured and you hedge all your resources, in a manner of speaking, to protect from all inimical interests. Because please remember that India today also bids fair to be a member of the Security Council of the United Nations Organization. You want to have greater say in the oceans and the seas across the world, purely from a strategic perspective, be it from the food security, the fuel security, or any other national security or strategic public interest point of view. From that bearing, it is critical that we look at maritime security. If you leaf through the Merchant Shipping Act, which is the parent legislation or the enactment for the merchant shipping of the marine sector in the country, you'll find that there is very little reference to maritime security. The typical nuance of maritime security is, this is just to initiate you, there is something called as the ISPS, International Ship and Port Facility Security Code, which is a product of the 9/11 incident in the United States of America, 9th of September in 2011. All of you are familiar with that. In a matter of months, the United States was able to push through, leverage its position as an international superpower to literally drive RAM into, through the IMO, this paradigm of the ISPS. What it essentially, quintessentially does is to secure your ports and ships in terms of access control. And this has now been incorporated into national legislation, into the Merchant Shipping Act. I will expand the scope of maritime security as I keep developing this topic of the day. So closer home, when we look at maritime security, the paradigm clearly refers to ISPS, which means all our ports in the country and all the vessels which come calling, and we have around 20,000 port calls by merchant ships on an average in any given calendar or financial year, as the case may be. So that's a fairly significant volume of exim trade, export-import trade. And I'm sure all of you are familiar, we have 12 major ports in the country, one corporatized port, of course now with the enactment of the finance bill 2015, all major ports will eventually transform into becoming corporate ports. Aside from that, there are 187, shall I say, I would refrain from using the pejorative term minor ports, but they're all non-major ports. So if you want to secure your maritime boundaries in regard to all these assets that you have and make sure that you need to have robust access control measures, then the ISPS code is what you need to look at. This code is part of the SOLAS convention. All of you have heard of SOLAS, I would assume. Safety of life at sea. So this is not a standalone, the ISPS is not a standalone proposition. It is an integral component of the SOLAS convention, which came about in the year 2002 and then eventually got internationalized in 2004. However, as against 200 odd ports, I'm afraid all we have today is a coverage of no more than about 44 ports in the country which are ISPS compliant. The rest still have a lot of ground to cover. Of course, admittedly, I must draw the line here. Not all ports need to be ISPS compliant for a very simple reason, that as long as they do not engage in exim trade, perhaps there is no interface as such. But that said, a lot of ground needs to be covered in regard to ISPS compliance. Let me then move on to the national fleet. We have approximately about 1,216 Indian flag merchant vessels. We represent no more than about 1.7% of the global tonnage worldwide. We rank a fairly low 17th in the global matrix of maritime nations in terms of our overall tonnage. Only about 10% of our exim cargo is moved on Indian flag bottoms, 90% is on. We incur about $54 billion of freight bill annually. That aside, the fact that our ships, and in that the breakout is 370 odd Indian flag merchant ships are ocean going. The rest are all hugging the coast and engaging in coastal trade. So if your fleet of 370 strong merchant ships need to traverse the oceans and crisscrossing all the seven continents, then you need to ensure that they're fairly secure. What are the challenges on the maritime security front that you typically encounter in the globe? Piracy has been a mythical concept. You know, it dates back to the good old times when a pirate was, you know, romanticized, shall I say. Of course, there's nothing romantic about a pirate, but the end of it, but he's romanticized. And I can just share a small snippet with you. A pirate has been a favorite pastime with Hollywood. I'm told no fewer than 260 odd Hollywood movies have centered around the theme of piracy worldwide. It's a different matter that pirates have gone laughing their way to the bank all the way, and it's us who keep paying for the tickets to watch pirate movies. I don't know how many of you have seen Captain Phillips. Have you? Okay. So that's a fairly contemporary film, and I must say it's an extraordinarily well-made movie, so much so that I was enticed to see that on two consecutive days back-to-back in Mumbai. I've never done that with any movie in my life. So that's the second time I took my family as well. Now, the concept of piracy was fairly far removed, was alienated for the Indian subcontinent. You typically had armed robbery. Historically, if you look back in time, it was more an incidence of armed robbery. I mean, if you sort of looked at the neighborhood, you had the Malacca Straits, where, you know, Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, and the like. Those of you who had seafaring careers behind you, I'm sure would have traveled there. So that was a hot spot, technically, quote unquote, known as armed robbery area. Now, armed robbery was fairly benign or benevolent if you compare today with a modern day pirate. I mean, benign and benevolent for a very simple reason, that all that they engaged was, I mean, there was no physical harm that befell the seafarer or the crew of a merchant ship which was attacked. But all they did was to pilfer the cargo, the ship stores, and perhaps the personal effects of the crew members. And in a matter of a few minutes or an hour or so, they would make their exit after they had looted the cargo. So this was the traditional mold of an armed robber on the high seas. We have come a long way since then. What happened is, I'm sure some of you are familiar, if not all of you. Come the year 2008, that was a watershed year in the maritime security chapter of worldwide shipping. That's when suddenly the world sat up and took notice of Somali piracy. Now, Somalia was consigned to a nook and cranny of the geography of the world. We all know from 1991, Somalia has been a failed state. It has been racked by clan kinsmanship, fratricidal tribal war, absolute collapse of governance, no state structure was the name, no law and order at all. The writ of the state simply doesn't run anywhere in any part of Somalia. But what happened is that 2008 onwards, you had a sudden surge in piracy driven by Somali pirates in the coast of Somalia, or the Gulf of Aden, or the Horn of Africa, as it is known as, or simply put, East African waters. In the span of 4 years, from around middle of 2008 till about the first half of 2012, there was a sudden spiraling of Somali piracy. There were instances when, on an average, in a month, and please remember that the coast of Somalia is one of the critical maritime routes connecting the east-west corridor. So there's enormous maritime traffic which traverses these routes. So then it was like a sitting duck. On an average, during the peak, about 16 merchant vessels used to get hijacked in a month. That was the extent of incidents in piracy over there. It is not all. There was a virulent aspect, there was a violent facet to Somali piracy, because it was often traumatization of the seafarers. There have been instances where there have been fatalities, and please don't get unduly perturbed or alarmed, those of you cadets. This is just to give you a sense of realism. Things have abated considerably. I can assure you, as I go along, I'll sort of assuage you. But going back in time, in 2008-09, you had this spiraling out of control of Somali piracy. At a point came when a vessel used to be in captivity for an average of around 2 to 3 months. and would get released on payment of ransom, and it was not small change. It was a staggering sum of anywhere between $2.5 to $3.5 million of payout for release of every vessel. And during the captivity, every conceivable form of torture, be it psychological or physical, used to be perpetrated on board by the Somali pirates. Typically, you would assume that these are these very scrawny, scraggy, you know, very skinny type of bunch of ragtag urchins who come and commandeer a vessel and, you know, take it away and the like. But there is a method to this whole madness, and I'll explain why over a period of time for the last 5 years, I have kept saying this in platform after platform, and I'm open to challenge on this, that Somali piracy, when it existed in its peak, was probably one of the best case of multinational corporations, which is extremely successful. You had a board of directors at the background who ran this literally orchestrated empire. Then you had the fringe players, the marginal, the foot soldiers and the like. There was sharing of the booty. But at the end of the day, all that these guys, about half a dozen chaps who would hijack a vessel would get is about an average of $30,000. And the rest of it would flow back as illicit proceeds of money. This is as international or as organized or transnational a cross-border crime that you can look at possibly, be it smuggling, human trafficking and the like. Piracy ranks at par with that. So typically what would happen is that the hijacks would occur, and this only kept escalating because the international community did not know for the first few months to a year as to what was happening. I mean, they were in a daze. It was difficult for them to react and respond in a very structured manner. The first step, that fledgling step that was taken, was in February 2009, when the Security Council of the United Nations Organization passed a resolution stating that under the UNCLOS, those of you familiar with the UNCLOS, that international navies were authorized to do just about anything, to do whatever it took to put an end to the menace of piracy, which means that even with use of force that they could do to put a full stop to this. So there was this authorization or empowerment of the international navies deriving powers of the UNCLOS. And then there was a body created known as CGPCS, Contact Group on Piracy of the Coast of Somalia, which is an international body consisting of about 70 member states of the United Nations and a whole host of multinational organizations ranging from the Interpol, International Police Organization, the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, UNODC, and a host of other players were associated, whose mandate was to try and combat piracy as it existed then in off the coast of Somalia. What was happening was that over a period of time, there was this bear and dare facet of Somali piracy. They became more and more bolder, they became more emboldened, and then the extent of piracy the boundaries kept getting pushed, so much so that at a point in time, in around 2011, they came up to the Indian Ocean, the western region of the Indian Ocean, and they were virtually about 400 to 500 nautical miles off the Indian coastline at that point in time. So what happened is that what is of interest to you, and I must share this very openly, is that we were somehow, the Indian national crew were the most victimized. Of the 5,400 seafarers who were captured and held captive as hostages by the Somali pirates over the five-year period from 2008 before it started abating in May 2012, no fewer than 343 were Indian national seafarers. The largest and the most representative number or the chunk of that. So it started hitting us very hard. I mean, the point was driven home savagely to Indian government because, and mercifully, and the only redeeming feature was that none of these merchant vessels was of an Indian flag, touch wood, till date, not a single Indian flag vessel has been commanded or hijacked. But all these seafarers of Indian nationality who got picked up and were held for different points in time, ranging from a few days to as much as 4 years and 1 month, and that's the extent, and I'll come to some of the specific cases, is that they were all Indian nationals. The The other redeeming feature is that after MT Smyrni, which was a Marshall Island flag vessel, which was hijacked on May 10th, 2012, not a single merchant ship has been successfully hijacked by Somali pirates since then, although there have been sporadic attacks and attempts made, but none of them has been successful. So what really sort of enabled the containment of Somali piracy? There were a couple of factors which, because the turn of events completely overtook the international maritime community and the law enforcement community. So as I said, they had to do something about it. If you're familiar with the geographical coordinate, there is something called as an IRTC, internationally recognized transit corridor. IRTC is a 490 nautical miles extent and a width of 20 nautical miles. That is the terrain on the waters of the coast of Somalia or the Gulf of Aden or the Horn of Africa, which is sanitized and monitored by the international navies. So that is known as also sometimes known as a recognized transit corridor or the recommended transit corridor. Recommended from the point of view of maritime security, because you are, the sea lanes are secured to that extent. But this IRTC, the Somali pirates made a complete nonsense of this IRTC concept, because they literally ran amok in those 3 to 4 years. And so finally, it was decided that the global navies had to step in, intercede, intervene, and then, so at this point in time, since the last 4 years, it has taken enormous resources of the global navies. And you will not believe it, even as we speak, there are 42 naval assets, warships, frigates, destroyers, and whatever, what have you. They're all positioned in this area. They patrol these waters, keep constant maritime vigil of this coast alone. And 42, I mean, if you look at the costs exponentially over the 5 years, it's a fairly staggering amount which the international community has paid to contain this phenomenon. So the navies have played a very, very significant role. And here I must add that primarily the navies are under the banner of three bodies called as CMF, Combined Maritime Forces. You have the EU NAVFOR, which is the European Union Naval Forces, and then the NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization. So these are the principal naval forces which are deployed there. Aside from there, there are about half a dozen bodies which are called as independent deployers, IDs. Countries like Japan, India, China, Malaysia, Russia, South Korea, which have deployed either one or two of their own naval vessels to patrol these waters. So collectively, it is an armada consisting of about 42 vessels drawn in, pooled in by all these navies. We, India, is committed to having one of its frigates constantly patrolling this water since 2008. It's not obviously the same frigate. There isn't a turnaround, but suffice to say, at any point of time, there is one Indian naval warship which is part of that. And one of the best things that happened then is that the entire merchant shipping fleet which was moving that path along its east-west traffic corridor movement was getting secured through what is known as a convoy escort. The ships were getting protected when they traversed that range, that stretch of Somalia, by an armed naval convoy escort, of which India is a contributor. Our ship is part of the convoy escort, and we are happy to say that from the Directorate General of Shipping, we have been involved in that process to the extent that we've issued advisories to the Indian merchant fleet that whenever their vessels travel that, they need to notify us in advance, and that notification happens, an intimation is electronic, it is on an e-mode. That communication comes to our DGCOM center, which is the DG communication center, which runs 24/7. And then that is relayed in turn to the Indian Navy, and then it is all stitched up with the international navies, and then a schedule is drawn of escorts by naval warships. So then the ships are then recommended that if you want to move on a given date or a given month in this for a voyage, then this is the escort convoy that is available to secure your movement unfettered on those waters. This has gone on, and it continues. There is a commitment globally by all these international forces that they will stay the course in Somalia to sanitize, cap, and contain this phenomena till at least 2016. That is the current mandate. But going forward, hopefully, the situation is As I said, it is abated, it is capped for the moment, but dare I say that it's probably not irreversible, for a simple reason that Somalia, as a country where the causative factors are rampant unemployment, I mean, terrible levels of corruption, as I said, complete lack of governance structures, complete void absence of rule of law, etc., and abject poverty and the like. So all these are a very, very heady cocktail or a recipe for disaster. And unless the international community rises to the challenge of trying to enable development and economic growth of Somalia as a country, and that's happening very, very painfully slow, my gut sense is that probably we will have this as a continued threat for the next 20 to 30 years. But as to what levels of challenge it will pose to the international maritime community is anybody's guess. So you will have to secure, from a maritime perspective, these sea lanes for a good 10 to 20 years from now. That's the way I see it going forward. The United Nations Secretary General, in his report, there is an annual report which he is mandated to submit to the Security Council and the General Assembly. Mr. Ban Ki-moon is the present Secretary General of the UN. So in his last report submitted on the 16th of October 2014, he's actually drawn attention to the fact that amongst the international hotspots on the maritime area, hotspots are those vulnerable pockets which exist. I mean, it is even said that even in South America, Malacca Straits is actually now resurfacing as a problem area, parts of the South China Sea, etc., and equally importantly, Somalia and the West Africa, and I'll come to that in a while. So these are the hotspots identified by the United Nations. So the Secretary General's report states that while piracy has been contained, has been sort of capped or restricted to a large extent in Somalia, he still states that the process is not to be deemed as irreversible, that it has the potential of resurfacing all over again. The only saving grace or the silver lining that he projects in his report is to the extent that the number of attacks have reduced, that there is no successful hijackers yet. The average payout in terms of ransom have obviously declined because after May 10th of 2012, there has been no successful attack at all, from a high of around $3.5 million to as low as about $1 million, etc. And what is of salience is that the extent or the outreach of the Somali pirates, which used to extend to about 450 nautical miles on average, that was a range to which they could make an audacious or a daring attack and pick up targets literally for their asking, has now receded to only about 50 nautical miles of the Somali coast. And that is proven empirically with the fact that today the maritime traffic is literally hugging the Somali coast. It's a little dare and bear situation. It's a bit foolhardy on the part of the merchant shipping to go as close still, because you know it's risking your lives way too much on a facile assumption that all is well in Somalia, all is not well, clearly speaking. What is also of interest for you to note is that when the Somali pirates, and they are called under a respectable terminology as PAGs, pirate action groups, that's because they are groups which attack. You know, literally, if you go to the coastlines, the southern coasts of Somalia, this is like a cottage industry. Piracy is a cottage industry, literally there. You have young boys who are all waiting to go to the sea. They have vessels ready with provisions, heavy armory, artillery, weapons, and the like. And then there are the village elders, etc., who, you know, start looking out. There is a watch and ward which is kept. And then they simply launch off. So these are the typical traditional vessels. What they typically do as a modus operandi is that, I hope you're not getting bored, because I'm getting into a bit of details essentially to drive home the point of the menace of piracy in its overall contours. So what typically happens with the Somali pirates is that they launch off these attacks. They pick up, let's say, a sailing vessel or a fishing vessel. They commandeer it. Either they could probably finish off, kill their crew and just dump their bodies in the sea, or hold them as hostages, put them on their vessels, and then keep that vessel, the hijacked sailing or a fishing vessel as what is called as a mother vessel. A mother vessel is typically used to launch further attacks. That means artillery, the weapons, the stockpile of weapons, provisions, and everything else, all resources are all piled up there. It is there in some coordinate, geographical coordinate of the sea. And that is used as a backup to draw those and keep launching attacks time and again. And the vessels which they use are known as skiffs, S-K-I-F-F-S. And these are fast speedboat type interceptor patrol boats and the like. So they have agility. They have obviously a very uncanny eye to pick up spot vessels. And the typical attacks are those vessels which have a free low board. Low freeboard, the other way around. Over a period of time, when the international community started wisening up, apart from naval deterrence, what the shipping community has done is primarily twofold. They have spawned an alternate industry known as the armed security industry that has grown by leaps and bounds over the last 4 to 5 years. There are bodies known as the private maritime security companies, PMSCs, and they're personally are known as PCAS, privately armed contracted security personnel. So today this is a very flourishing industry. There are service providers who, for a fee, for a consideration, are able to provide you armed guards who board your merchant ships, provide that security cover. So this has been a necessary evil. The IMO, in all its wisdom, has said that, look, given the situation, the imminent context, we cannot wish the maritime security industry, security arms industry away. It is a reality, it is here to stay. But let's deal with that, and I'll come to that as to how the IMO and the other bodies have dealt with this. There are obvious flip sides to having armed guards on board merchant ships. While it provides you a sanitization and a security cover for sure, and I must say, what is equally compelling is that not a single merchant vessel anywhere, be it Somalia or anywhere else, which had a contingent of armed guards, and typically the detachment or deployment is about 4 to 5 armed security guards who are under the control of the master. The command and control structure lies with the master of the merchant ship. He has the last word. So all these guys are supposed to report to him. So not a single vessel having on board a merchant vessel having on board the armed security guards has been hijacked till date, because clearly the firepower and the sheer physical presence of these armed security guards is more than enough deterrent for the pirates to back off. So typically what happens is the pirates try and fire warning shots. If there's no reciprocal fire coming about from the merchant ship, and which is what happens, then they assume that, this is a wet vessel which is an easy prey. It's a good picking, so then they launch an attack on that. But obviously when you have the armed guards, so then that wards off an attack. So the presence of the armed security industry has been a second significant deterrence and has been one of the arsenals in maritime security cover in this very, very volatile region. The third has been, of course, before I move on, I must also tell you, over a period of time when the armed security guards went about their business, there was a huge concern raised, and well-meaning concerns, that what happens, there is an absence or a void or a vacuum of two fundamental propositions called as rules of use of force, rules of use of proportionality, proportionate usage of force, and rules of engagement. These are military terms, but these are typically used when you have armed security guards as well. Now, who decides what shall be the proportionate response in terms of firepower that you unleash? If there's an attack, let's say, of a 303 rifle from the pirates, would you use an AK-47 or an AK-56 in response? So these are challenges which came up for consideration. Rules of engagement. How do you do? Do you fire warning shots, or do you simply blast the pirate vessel off the surface of the waters? What do you do with that? So these are matters of concern, because at the end of the day, there is something called as a humanitarian angle, much as we are averse to using humanitarian nuances for pirates. But finally, there is justice. They have their own rights. Otherwise, you have activists and everybody else gunning for you. So under those circumstances, these were propositions which were getting agitated. So the IMO said that you need to do something about it. So as a result, the IMO tasked the ISO, the International Standards Organization, which is another UN body, to come out with recommended standards on usage of force, proportionality, and rules of engagement. So what the ISO did in the year 2012-13, towards the end of 2013, is they came out with what is called as ISO PAS, PAS 28,000 regulations. ISO publicly accepted standards, PAS is the acronym, 28,007, that's a series. So this covers, this is essentially a regulatory regime. It is an advisory, it is recommended, it's not mandatory, because the international community cannot mandate what you as a sovereign country can do. All it can say is that this is an advisory, this is a good recommended best practice, and you may like to follow this. So the recommended practice under 28,007 ISO PAS is that there must be control, the command and control structure must lie with the master. He will have the final call to, or the take, as to whether the armed security guards will be unleashed, what they shall do, and thereafter they shall be under his control. It is very well to say that you've had these standards, but a lot of countries have simply not accepted it, because that comes in a wake another set of challenge, and which is what India has been voicing its concern in the IMO. What happens that when you have a whole bunch of foreign armed security guards which are traversing not your territorial waters, but your contiguous zone or your EEZ, and how on earth do we distinguish them from a non-state actor, an inimical interest, whose intention is to jeopardize or imperil your own maritime security? For example, if a neighbor, and I obviously don't want to take names here, if somebody were to say that a vessel of that flag was to travel along the Indian EEZ with a cache of arms and ammunition without even notifying the coastal or littoral state as to what was the carriage about, what was their intent. So India has been pushing the boundaries in the IMO and saying that the least that the international community should get around and do is to introduce a regulatory regime under which it shall become obligatory, if not mandatory, on every merchant shipping, merchant vessel carrying armed guards on board to notify in advance every coastal or littoral state that yes, this is our period of passage in your waters, this is what we are carrying, these are the number of personnel, this is our cache of arms and ammunition, this is the inventory. Some of the international community has not found favor of this proposition, but of course we continue to forcefully argue in favor of this. The concern is that under the UNCLOS, there is no mandatory requirement of this. There is a right of innocent passage. I'm sure some of you would have heard of this term, right of innocent passage. Now, the world turns around to India and says, hey, what are you talking about? UNCLOS doesn't mandate you. So what is the international regime over and above United Nations Convention of the Law of the Seas? So that's contradictory. But you're saying it's fine. UNCLOS was brought about at a time when the world was much more benign. Today, the situation has contextually changed as a paradigm shift. So you need to do something about it. Anyway, I'll park that thought there, merely leave it at that at this point. The other signal feature which sort of salvaged the situation for the maritime industry was the introduction of the best management practices, the BMP. I don't know how many of you have even read or heard about this. There is a booklet, and I just flashed this with you. There's a small booklet called as BMP4. This is the latest version. What the industry, the shipping industry did on its own is they decided that after the Somali piracy phenomenon went out of hand, literally went out of hand in the year 2008 onwards, they said that they need to do some kind of a due diligence and introspect and do it for themselves. So then under the aegis of what is called as the round table, a round table is a body in London consisting of four major international shipping entities called as Intertanko, Intercargo, BIMCO, and ICS, International Chamber of Shipping. So these four players got together, formed a round table, and the round table is the author of this booklet, the BMP, the Best Management Practice. So what they did is they articulated what every ship which was to travel along beyond the IRTC on the Gulf of Aden or the Horn of Africa, the East African waters or off the coast of Somalia, that this is a recommended set of practices. For example, what does it say? Ideally, you should have a citadel or a safe house. I hope you understand what a citadel is. It's a safe house where it's like a cocoon or a balloon that you create. You secure yourself so that in the event of an attack by a pirate or a terrorist or whatever, you can all get hold into that one cabin, which is fairly firepower resistant, unless you blast it through an LMG and the like, ordinarily they can all resist a fair degree of firepower. It is fully equipped, fully provisioned for, let's say, for 3 to 4 days of food, water, communication channels independently, autonomous of the bridge and the other communications. So you could get hold and then call out for help, and hopefully somebody will reach out to you in those 1 or 2 days, and then you can hold on. So this is essentially a holding operation kind of a cell. So one of the recommended practices was, well, that most international ships, unfortunately not many Indian flag owners decided to do that because of cost reasons, because when the freight rates were plummeting down, shipping was nosediving, the Baltic rate index was actually plummeting, people thought this was not a good idea to invest in this thing, but it was still foolhardy. At the end of the day, if you lost an asset to a pirate, an asset, typically a ship, costs you anywhere from about $100 to $150 million on an average. That's the cost of that asset. It's still worth paying about $1 million and getting a safe house or a citadel constructed. Then there were some other recommended practices, like, you know, how do you have deterrence? You know, like you put spray, then you have chains, spikes, so that you deter. Then there is a provision for CCTV cameras, so that the footage, you know, when people board, you get to know exactly the movement, the stealth movement of the pirates, so that you're prepared, so people can come and lock yourself in the bridge or in the citadel, etc. So there's a whole set of recommended best practices. It's called as best management practices. It's by the industry, for the industry, and essentially it is entirely driven by the industry. So the BMP has done a world of good for the shipping community as a large, because a lot of them have, the moment they get into the IRTC area and beyond, immediately it is the mandated responsibility of the master of the ship to kick in or activate the BMP provisions immediately. And this stays the path until he exits the other end of the IRTC or even beyond the Somali waters. So primarily, there have been three deterrents. One is, of course, the Navy, the naval presence. The second is the armed security guards. And the third has been the BMP practice by the industry. But what happened as a result of all this, there have been instances where you've had trigger-happy armed guards. There have been instances of our own coast. We all know of Enrique Alexi, and I will not go beyond because it's subjudice to the highest court of the land, February 15, 2012. And it's all too familiar and fairly fresh in our memory. Then there's a case of Prabhudeva, another Indian vessel, fishing vessel, which was rammed. And in that collision, 5 Indian fishermen lost because, you know, then they were perceived as pirate attack ship, and so they were rammed at, you know. So these are some of the downsides. The other downside is that most of the international shipping traffic is hugging the Indian coast, and that stems from the fact that the high-risk area, the HRA, the high-risk area, which is supposedly prone, as defined in this booklet, has come as close to 78 degrees east longitude, which is virtually into the Indian EEZ. So we have been fighting literally a losing battle until now to get this HRA redrawn to 65 degrees east longitude, so that we say that, look, there has been not a single instance of piracy the way we understand in the Indian coast, off the Indian coast, anywhere up to 500 nautical miles, since a vessel called MV Egeltine was hijacked off this area on 26th of March 2012. That was the last incident, so it's pretty much 3 years down the line. So HRA, what it has led to is the asymmetry because of the HRA. Insurance premium have gone up exponentially higher. That incidence of high premiums is being borne by the shippers, and then it is passed on to the final consumers. On an average, the Indian consumers have been paying about $3.2 billion annually towards additional war risk premium as a result of this extension of the high risk area. So that is a case we have been trying to push very, very closely. There is another phenomenon, ladies and gentlemen, which is of concern to us, which is of floating armories. That's another maritime security challenge, which is of fairly recent origin. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the term floating armories. Have you heard of this? Okay, floating armories are nothing but ships, typically merchant ships, cargo ships of relatively smaller size, which are floating armories in the sense that you have a stockpile of ammunition and arms which are kept there, essentially purportedly towards anti-piracy operations. So these vessels are anchored, are parked at strategic locations. For example, you have these about 8 to 10 floating armories in a place called Galle, G-A-L-L-E, of Sri Lanka, which is where you typically turn the west to the east corridor of India. You have in Fujairah, you have in Salalah in Oman, and a couple of other locations. There are about 8 strategic choke points where you have floating armories today. Now, these are well intended to the extent that these are meant for to combat piracy. But the concern is that if you have floating armories lurking on your close to your waters, then there is another significant challenge which it arises, which is if you have non-state actors from not so friendly or hostile countries, all that they need to do is to commandeer, hijack one of these floating armories, and then cause mayhem along your coast. So India has been vociferously arguing in various international fora that a time has come for the UN and the IMO to actually regulate this business of floating armories, because it's not doing anybody any good. You know, as long as it is all, it's hunky-dory, it's all is going well, it's fine. But the day something goes amiss, I mean, it didn't take much to drive home this point. For example, you're aware what happened in Tuticorin in October 2013. There was the U.S. vessel, I forget the name now, Seaman Guard Ohio 1, if you're aware of that. That exactly was a floating armory which was literally lurking off India's territorial waters, just 12 nautical miles off India. That, of course, is now part of a historic investigation and judicial prosecution. So that is, again, a matter of sub judice. So this floating armories are a matter of serious threat. So India has been submitting papers to the IMO that it is time that the international community sits up and takes notice and regulates the floating armories so that they do not become a serious maritime security threat, which otherwise they were not intended to. Then I'll just briefly take you to another phenomena which is now emerging as a far more virulent threat, including to India on the maritime security front, than it was ever thought of. Look at the West African waters, Nigeria, Angola, and the like. All we knew for a couple of decades was that this was prone to armed robbery attacks, typically ship stores, ship-to-ship transfers of cargo, which is primarily of fuel or energy supplies, crew personal effects, or you know, or any other cargo that was getting stolen. But those of you who have watched very closely from the year 2013, early 2013, a trend has emerged where now it has assumed the overtones of piracy in the West African waters, in the Gulf of Guinea. Traditionally, what is happening is that these pirates have now started emulating the Somali piracy model. They've decided that this makes good business sense, so you may try and replicate that. So in a small, modest scale, they've been hijacking ships, and coincidentally, as ill luck would have it, most of the vessels which were picked up, and these are all tankers primarily, because tanker trade is fairly popular there, and carrying fuel and energy supplies, have been Indian seafarers, and most importantly, they have targeted the officer crew, which is the master, the chief officer, the chief engineer, and the like. Unfortunately, one of the Indian chief engineers died in an attack, I think it was early 2014. He belonged to Lucknow. But in repeat instances, I know of 4 cases. I mean, I don't want to name the vessel because I don't think it's that worth the while here. But analytically, we have seen that in every one of these cases, the crew has been hijacked, kept in custody for relatively smaller periods of time, from about a week to about maximum 1 month, but released only on payment of ransom in the West African waters, and also subjected to ill treatment. So this is a new phenomenon which is disturbing, which we have drawn the attention of the international community that while Somali piracy may have receded in the background, momentarily perhaps, or hopefully for all times to come, but here is a new avatar or an incarnation which the world should sit up and take notice. So the West African waters are no more benign. The unfortunate part is that the naval presence in the West African waters is relatively minimalistic because there are not too many navies which are patrolling. For example, we don't have the outreach. It's a good 2,500 nautical miles away from India. So you can't position a naval asset there. It's humongously expensive. It's just out of the question. So this is another area which is a hotspot which has been highlighted, as I said, in the report of the Secretary General of the United Nations Organization. I must also share with you as to, this is the positive for all of you, and I'm saying with the utmost, with due deference and with utmost modesty, that whenever we have had this instances of Indian seafarers getting picked up, and there have been 343, as I said, and what is reassuring is that but for two fatalities, except for two Indians who got killed, one on board the ship during the hijack, and one Indian who has mysteriously disappeared from a ship during captivity and has not been seen alive since 8th of September 2011. Other than this, all the 341 Indians have all safely come back, but after being in captivity for prolonged spells, anywhere from 2-3 months to, as I said, an all-time high of 4 years and 1 month. The recent case in point was, I don't know whether you followed stories of Asphalt Venture. This was a release on 30th of October 2014, I beg your pardon, where they were captured on 28th of September 2010. And so they were released eventually after that period of time. So they finally came back home safely. So the government of India, in collaboration with several stakeholders, has been extremely proactive in ensuring the release of this. So we have engaged ourselves in direct and what we call as track to or back channel negotiations, not for payment of ransom, trust me. No negotiations directly with the pirates, not a single rupee paid as ransom at all, but purely persuasively using influences with various stakeholders who have a footprint in Somalia to try and get the release out. So we've leveraged, for example, institutions like Interpol, International Police Organization, United Nations of Office on Drugs and Crime, and some of the other local NGOs. And I'm happy to say that through this rigorous, consistent, and persuasive efforts, in every case, we've been able to manage to get back every one of our seafarers safe and sound back home. It's not that. I mean, we then liaise with the Indian diplomatic missions, the embassy, the high commissions in those countries. You know, then all facilitation and help is provided to the seafarers on the release, so that the moment they're released from Somalia, the first point of arrival is Kenya. It's Nairobi in Kenya, because Nairobi is the neighboring country. Somalia is the neighboring country of Kenya. So they come there, then the diplomatic mission takes over. Many times we have sent our officers. So in those 4 or 5 days, then the released seafarers are then taken into protective custody, medical assistance, psychological counseling, a new set of clothes, extra few dollars is provided so that they can go shopping. And after that, they are brought, flown back home at Government of India expenses. Often, Government of India aircrafts have been sent when the numbers have been large, and special aircrafts which have picked them up and brought them back. And we have ensured that there afterwards, and this is where I want to be very, very positive and upfront with you by stating that even during the period of captivity, we have reached out to every single seafarer's family unfailingly, and I'm saying this with utmost modesty, as I said, every time, more often than not, I've picked up a phone and called up the wife or the child of those seafarers and reassured that everything is possible under the sun is being done to get their husbands or parents, the father back. So it is traumatic. Believe me, it's extremely painful, because beyond a point, every time you keep saying this, the family starts disbelieving you. They're saying that you're just making absolute tissue of lies. You're keeping and repeating this. But say, believe us, trust us. Somalia is a state where there's no government worth the name. If it were to be a country where there was a government, we could have possibly got them out much, much faster. You're dealing with something where there is a complete vacuum, there's a void. You don't even know whom to talk to. That's the kind of scenario that is there. But so we have kept the families engaged. Beyond that, I mean, you might think that's very superficial. What we've also done is, wherever possible, we have provided employment to the spouses. Just to narrate, two of the Asphalt Venture men who were there, seven, their wives turned out to be qualified teachers. I went out of my way, met the Commissioner Kendra Vidyalaya twice over in the span of 2013-14, requested him to engage these ladies as teachers, even if it is contractual, in Kendra Vidyalaya. I'm happy to say that one of them is working in Vishakhapatnam Kendra Vidyalaya, another lady is working in Cochin. So a small little step. We've also provided employment opportunities to the sister and brother in private jobs of a couple of other seafarers. Two children of seafarers, again, or coincidentally of the Asphalt Venture, they still are studying. One of them is studying in Manet, Pune, you're aware, in an engineering, BE in marine engineering. Another boy is doing BE marine engineering in a college in Cochin. I spoke to the principal. I'm happy to state that a 90% fee waiver we've managed to obtain for these boys on the premise that, look, their father is in captivity. Here is a mother. Obviously, she may not have adequate means of support. So this is the smallest gesture, the least that you can do as an outreach. And I must acknowledge that the principals have been very responsive. They have waived in our request, and I ensured that it is not just one-time waiver. Every semester fee is waived to the extent of 90%. So those boys are getting this till they graduate. This is even after the fathers have come back. We have ensured that that facility continues to exist for them till the boys graduate, because the fathers have not got back to sea as yet. Substantially, what we've also done is that we have engaged the Indian shipping community, the Indian National Ship Owners Association, the Indian Coastal Conference of Ship Owners Association, and I'm happy to state that out of the 33 seafarers who came back in the last 2 years, 11 opted out because they were in a fantastic company, Dynacom Tankers and the other places. So those companies voluntarily took them back. The remaining 22 who were defenseless, who didn't have any job because they were employed by foreign shipping companies, which were either one ship company or they belonged to flags of convenience who did nothing for them in the entire period of captivity. I'm happy to state that 18 of these men have now got back to sea thanks to the efforts of the Maritime Administration and the shipping community. They're all sailing back on different contracts. Some of them have preferred to sail on the coastline. Some have preferred to go on the offshore sector. Some have been a bit more venturesome. They've gone on to the ocean going. So this is the relief and rehabilitation we continue to provide. This is apart from the monetary assistance in terms of solatium that the government of India has released on the recommendation of the DG Shipping. For example, on an average, about 5 lakhs has been paid to the families of each of these seafarers during the period of the captivity, just as way of basic sustenance. The boy who's missing for the last 3.5 years, his family has ended up getting 11 lakhs till date in 3 different tranches. So this is a small, modest outreach which we attempt. And I'm saying it again very deferentially that as a result of all these cumulative efforts, in the United Nations meeting on 14th of May 2014, in that World Forum, India was acknowledged as being the best maritime nation in terms of an outreach for relief and rehabilitation to its seafarers anywhere in the globe. Thank you very much for that. This is a collective effort for a whole lot of people. So that is on record that the UN has commended the efforts of India and has recommended that this is a model worthy of emulation by everyone who is similarly impacted. So, but this is an ongoing process. Now, when you look at what needs to be done in terms of Somali crisis, as I said, a whole lot of initiatives are underway. There is something called as EU CAP Nestor there, essentially to try and reform the judiciary, beef up or reinforce the police, law enforcement agencies, to step up development and growth in the economy so that, you know, that provides that kind of a buffer or a deterrent for the young boys to venture out. But it's going to be a long, long haul, because I see that the sheer scale of the problem in Somalia is so enormous that I think it defies very simplistic solutions. And to add to the complications is the presence of Al-Shabaab in Somalia. Al-Shabaab is an affiliate, is a branch of Al-Qaeda. And there is tremendous sway that Al-Shabaab has over large tracts of territory in Somalia. It's such a pitiable state that barring Mogadishu, the capital city of Somalia, and that too even just one-third of the territory of its own capital city, the federal government there, the federal government, elected, democratically elected government, doesn't have its writ run large anywhere else. So you can imagine the kind of situation that you deal with. Every regional leader is a self-styled president or a prime minister, or call you what he likes, and then you have to deal with him. He's a warlord, he's a chieftain, he's a feudal chap, he's got his own militia, armed militia of 500 to 1,000 guys who are under his beck and call. So you deal with it, and these are all mercenaries. Apart from being criminal elements, these are rank mercenaries for whom this is nothing but an extortionist racket. So the complexity of the challenge in Somalia is still very much out there. The jury is out as to whether you can cap it, but the redeeming feature is that as we speak, for the last 3 odd years, things have been normalized, not a single much, and touchwood, as I said, God willing, hope it stays that way. But challenges are manifold elsewhere. There is another, just to wind up here, very recently you would have been hearing, I'm sure the TVs are awash, the media coverage of the boat people. You've heard of this in the Mediterranean, what's happening in Italy, France, and the like. You have droves of illegal migrants swarming into the European water, into the European coast, at great risk to life, African descent, They're moving in from Libya, I mean, in other places. So they are now, that is the next maritime security challenge. I mean, illegal migrant movement has always been a challenge in the past because it's very much an organized transnational crime, cross-border crime. But it has now gone to the next level because here you are now confronted with this boat people. I mean, there's a beautiful article on this if you read The Economist, the latest edition of The Economist, is how the European powers are today literally running for cover, not knowing how do they deal with this new challenge of maritime security. You have thousands of people who are literally flooding the shores of Europe, coastline. The Coast Guard is not able to do, and worse still, you would have heard and read in the papers that almost about 1,000 people have died because in ill-fated tragic incidents where the boats that they took have actually capsized, have sunk, drowned in the Mediterranean, and so 1,000 lives in the matter of just last 10 days is a staggering fatality or a casualty number. So now the European Union is on the overdrive. The UN is now deciding to do something about it. So illegal migration is another maritime sector challenge which you will willy-nilly face apart from the traditional forms of smuggling and the like. I believe I've overshot my time. So I'll be happy to take questions because I think I've pretty much covered the broad area. I mean, one can keep dissecting it further, but I think there's no good being done. There's one report which I wanted to mention to you. There's a body called as UNODC itself, United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. It talked about the fact that the transnational, it's a report is entitled, it's October 13, 2013, and the release says the menace of transnational organized crime in West Africa now. So the point that I was making is that the West African model is a matter of serious threat, and international communities are seriously engaged as to how do you deal with this challenge. So overall, in sum, what I wanted to present is, if you scan the globe anywhere, not just the maritime domain, and I'll come to that, there is something called as maritime domain awareness, which is important. The maritime domain, or the general security situation the world over, is extremely critical, very, very fragile. You look at what is happening in, thanks to the ISIS in Syria, you have in Libya and everywhere else, and many other countries, in Egypt, etc. You have a collapse of the state, typically. There is a resurgence of fanaticism. So you have all terrorist groups which are now prying in. So the spillover of all this is, it's a very, very deadly potent of mix. So it is inevitable that the worldwide security environment is going to impact maritime sector. Whether we like it or not, it is not immune to that. Given the general fragility of the environment, the strategic environment the world over, it is but natural that the maritime sector is going to get adversely impacted. I mean, there's no escaping that. And that is where, to wind up, I just want to leave this thought with you, that there's a concept of maritime domain awareness. Maritime domain awareness, simply put, means that you have to keep your eyes and ears open. You have to connect all the dots, which means you scan your coast, identify where are the leakages. For example, post 26/11, are we any wiser? Are we better equipped than what we were at that point of time? I mean, with all the measures of coastal security, is something we need to ask for ourselves. Now, there is this AIS mapping, automated identification system mapping, where you're supposed to ensure that, you know, the position reporting happens, you're able to see and identify every single vessel so that even a fishing vessel doesn't escape the net. It's a challenge which you will face as future mariners, where it's not just simplistically cargo movements, etc., but there are other extraneous elements which will bear on your efficiency and your very own survival, both as a vessel and as a mariner. The last point I want to make is that the world in the future, you will have a completely new paradigm or subset of challenges which will be cyber-driven. It is well said that you have traditional warfare, symmetrical warfare, but what is in store in future, when the next generation warfare will be unleashed, it will be what is called as the fourth generation warfare or the asymmetrical warfare. And that will be played on the battleground of cyber war, which means it will be driven on your computers. The risk for you is to the extent that increasing computerization, digitization of the vessels will lend that vessel to be that much more risky And this is not just I'm not just fantasizing it. This is a real life scenario possibility that all you would do is if you have increased levels of computerization, electronization of vessels, then there's every likelihood that through malware, which is malicious codes or algorithms written, all you need to do is to, for somebody, God forbid it doesn't happen, but if it were to happen, then you can simply commandeer a vessel. The master will find that he has no control where he's being led because the mal program is literally driving you to some other destination, and you could be in the hands of Al-Qaeda or someone else for all you know. I mean, you lose complete control over the command and control of the vessel because it's being driven by a program which has been written by somebody else and actually controlled robotically. So this is where I just want to finally wind up by saying that there is a project in the, which is funded by the European Union called as MUNIN, Mobile Unmanned Navigation in Intelligence Networks. This is driven by artificial intelligence, AI, which sees that in about 5 to 10 years or even 15 years down the line, you'll have vessels. That this is not to say that all of you are going to get displaced and unemployed, but be that as it may, you'll have a possible situation where maybe some types of vessels, some typology of vessels will be completely robotically driven, unmanned. Now that is where the scare scenario is, because then if those are high value assets, then you have players who are inimical who will see to it as to how through cyber warfare they can commandeer that, take hold of that, and then wreck mayhem everywhere. With these few words, thank you so much for your very kind attention, and I'll be more than happy to take questions. I'll stand here and take the questions if you have. So this was an overview. Thank you so much. Yeah, please, if you can take a mic, identify yourself.
Good evening, sir.
Hi.
Sir, in city like Chennai, Mumbai, and Kolkata, there is plenty of maritime institutions. And now, day by day, the number is increasing as a general store shop. Sir, my question is that, why DG Shipping is providing affiliation to this institution to run Piracy courses? Is it for revenue source? Or second question, what is the future prospect of the cadets who are pursuing their courses in government institutions? Sir, please have a glance on it.
Okay. I knew that this was in the coming. Okay, as a VC would have it, if you don't mind, we can pick up questions related to the topic first. But nonetheless, I'll answer you, don't worry. So we'll just hold it back, front-end it a little later. So if you could just shoot questions to me which are related to what I just spoke about.
Good afternoon, sir. Myself, Cadet Alec from BTech third year. Sir, recently I came through an article of the Economic Times that our sea is no longer a benign medium. And as you have also stated just now that our wastewater is no more a benign medium. So, sir, I would like to ask you that, is it only piracy the main cause? Is it only contributing the major chunk of this kind of downpour? So, is only piracy responsible for all these things, or some other factor is also playing a role, a helping hand, beyond this unbenign medium?
Well, piracy is certainly not in our waters, for sure. If you look at our waters, they're pretty much safe today. As I said, the Somali piracy phenomenon never even came fairly close to our coast. The most proximate coordinate was only 500 nautical miles. That was the farthest they ended up reaching the Indian shore. And today they have shrunk to no more than 50 nautical miles off the Somali coast. So if there are challenges in the maritime security, I'm saying that all you need to do is to be aware that there are these threats, and they need not necessarily be in your neighborhood, because when you're on an ocean-going voyage, you're traveling across the globe. You're crisscrossing different continents. So there are these typical fragile ecosystems or environments which you need to be aware of. Whether they bear down on you, cert for sure, or in what degree, it'll have to be case-to-case basis. It'll be entirely situational. That is why I want to harp again on the critical and imperative for you to be maritime aware, domain aware, I wouldn't say not challenged, but fully equipped. So which means you need to have your, you need to be, first of all, you need to play smart, you need to understand your skills very clearly, people skills with your colleagues in the crew. And I must just very briefly tell you that in these piracy situations, what we found very, very resoundingly reassuring was that people who were in custody of the hijacked vessels, they continued to maintain their cool and sanity. You know, otherwise people of lesser mortals, I mean, would have probably broken down, and I think there would have been clear fatalities. The fact that all, for example, these seven who came back from Asphalt Venture, what we found most remarkable was that they were extremely cool, collected, composed, even during, because we did extensive counseling sessions, we did debriefs from them. What we found is their ability to collaborate, even in a crisis, is what stood them in good stead. So your people skills are necessary for you. So these are some of the takeaways or lessons which you need to bear in mind. But there is no generalized one size fit all solution to say that, yes, you know, it's piracy only. Piracy is certainly not the only one. There can be several other situations. You can have armed robbery incidents, for example. You could have a terrorist attack, for instance. There's nothing connected with piracy. So these are the potentials. Beg your pardon?
And sir, one more question I have. As you have said, we can install a kind of enclave on our ship, which is totally resistant to the external attacks, which is totally resistant to the bombs and other attacks. So why we are not employing it frequently on our Indian ships?
You see, the point is, as I said, at the end of the day, there cannot be a mandate, a legislation-driven mandate that this must be put. There are cost implications to it. Perhaps the Indian vessels, some of them have, I must give it in all fairness, in due credit to them. Not all of them have adopted, however, because the fact is that they did a trade-off between investing that level of resource for creating a citadel or a safe house in their vessel, vis-a-vis, okay, employing an armed guard, for example. They said it's easier, it's much more cost-effective to do an armed guard proposition than doing this that way. And many of them have succeeded. In a current, in the contemporary times where freight rates are abnormally low, profit margins have shrunk to all-time lows, you know, and many of them are actually running, are not able to recover their capex, which is the capital expenditures. Some of them even not even recovering their opex, operational costs. Try telling them to do this, it's not easy to convince their board of directors. But I think they've been lucky. Some of them have played smart by engaging armed guards, which is why it's worked well for them.
Good afternoon, sir. Myself, Sanjeev Kumar, cadet from third year. Now you discuss about the jeopardy of piracy, and you told that nowadays we are the companies are hiring security officials on the ships. But recently, the thing is that the ship staff is being taught about the ways we can fight with the pirate attacks. So is it good that we are leaving the responsibility on the ship staff to fight piracy, or we should persistently hire the security official? Like, they are playing two roles, running the ship as well as fighting for the piracy.
You see, at the end of the day, if as seafarers, you need to be fully equipped, both mentally and physically, and also in terms of the requisite skill sets to combat any untoward situation. So to that end, you must also be fully prepared for a piracy attack. It's in your interest, individually and collectively, that you need to be trained, retrained, you need to learn, dislearn, unlearn, relearn. So which is what we have introduced programs, DG Shipping has mandatorily introduced programs for ship security officers, shipboard personnel, to ensure that they are aware of situations that in an event, in a worst case scenario, if there was a piracy attack, what is expected of you to be done? Now, it all depends, it all boils down to whether the company you are engaged with, you're contracted to, it's prudent enough to employ an armed security guard in which you can sit back, perhaps relax a little bit. You don't need to bother unduly, because that detachment of four to five security guards will completely take over the responsibility of sanitizing the environment for you in the ship. But if the owners decide for whatever reason that it's not worth it, or they can ill afford it, that's where your role becomes exponentially higher. You need the need to double up. But it's always useful for you to be trained mentally and physically to handle any given situation. I mean, now, if nothing else, it provides you that inner comfort that, yes, I can handle a situation. Otherwise, why should you feel completely helpless and leave somebody, your life at somebody else's mercy?
Good evening, sir. Sir, as you told about unmanned ships, I would like to ask you, as it is a curse or a boon in maritime sector, as it would be providing unemployment also, but it would be more efficient than manned ships.
Yeah, as I said, one has to take this project with a bit of pinch of salt today. I don't know how far it will succeed. The EU has sunk reportedly about $20 million in this project already. And it's still on a fairly advanced drawing board stage. Whether it sees the light of the day is anybody's guess. But I would safely assume that, and which I assured you, none of you need to fear that you'll get unemployed. I don't think worldwide shipping will be overtaken completely by unmanned ships. It's like a drone. I'm sure you'd have heard of what a drone is doing typically. So certain typologies, certain operations, certain typologies of vessels may perhaps get rendered, but I don't know what critical mass or what will be the scale at which this will get replicated worldwide. I don't think you need to bother in your generation. The next generation, we'll see when it comes.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Good evening, sir. My name is Dipanshu Jori, sir. I'm sailing as a second engineer, and I just recently signed off, and I'm from Lucknow. So in one of my vessels, in the month of January, there was a pirate attack, and there was an air shot, so pirates went away. So while signing the contract with the company, they have already mentioned that any HRA regions, they won't be giving any allowance or nothing to us. And then we had such incidents on board our ship in the month of January just. So we reported this incident to the company and told them for some compensation for saving the vessel, because you said that companies are taking higher freight rate and getting money and all those stuff. So why, like, companies are refusing, and when we are signing the contract, the vessel is going to HR region, we won't be compensated and all those stuff. So we would like to have some guidelines or something from you, or you have some view from your side.
Now, the specific situation that you underwent, I'm not too sure whether, was it along the coast of Somalia that when you were traveling?
Yeah, we were coming from Iran to Kandla for a discharge of cargo. So it was just near to the, like, Fujairah, just
near the
Fujairah, this that's down to that side.
Okay.
We had an incident, but if I should, they went away.
I'm not being disrespectful, to jump to a conclusion that it was a pirate attack is very difficult to hazard. There is something called as a reporting center. I don't know whether your vessel master reported that to the information reporting centers. For example, they are in Kuala Lumpur, there is UKMTO and the like, where you provide information. So immediately, the nearest naval reconnaissance aircraft will then take a sortie, look for it, identify whether it's actually a skiff or a pirate vessel. Otherwise, you could possibly have, you know, it could be a stray instance. So I would rather not hazard a guess and say that it is a piratical attack. But coming to the policy of the company, most companies are prudent. They do give cover by way of additional war risk insurance, but provided they are traveling along the Gulf of Aden or the Horn of Africa very clearly. Otherwise, they don't seek cover. Maybe Malacca Straits, yes, there is some additional war risk cover. But that's something you'll have to negotiate, you know, there is through collective bargaining agreement. It's difficult to drive it through a government process and insist that, because finally it's a demand and supply equilibrium. It's a matter of an entrepreneurial decision. But I would assume that a management which is in its right senses would ensure that they would want to safeguard their own crew at the end of it, you know. I mean, it'll be foolhardy for them to attempt something and say, I don't want to secure my crew, but I don't mind risking my $100 million ship. That'll be completely foolish. But I would not want to go that far and say what was the situation actually faced. But this is something that you'll have to collectively take through the CBA that you negotiate with the company. If not this time, maybe when it is due for renewal next time around. And again, one swallow does not make a summer, an isolated instance. So please don't panic typically. It could be attributable to different reasons. You'll have to go back and check from the company sources as to when it was reported to these information centers, what was the feedback. Your company will certainly have come to know whether it was attributed to piracy or it was it some other armed robbery attempt, There are many times armed robbery attempts. They're not piracy. Please understand. So that is a different ballgame. They're only targeting the cargo. So that's not at the level of piracy at all. And certainly in Fujairah, there's no question of a piracy as of today. That much I can vouch for you.
Good evening, sir. So I'm Cadet Avinash from BTEC second year. I read from a newspaper within 5 to 6 months before, I think, that some crew members were hijacked from Somalia like that. And after 4 years, they were left from there. So I wanted to ask you that why this much of a long time has been taken to left out from that place. That was so much bad time for them also. And this much of long time is like they have completed their four-year BTEC also there.
Yeah, I'm sure through distance learning, if you're able to provide them.
Thanks.
In Somalia, I wish we could do that, you know. We can have an MOU with the pirates, I guess, that okay, as long as you keep them in custody, we then do distance learning, I suppose, yes. But anyway, jokes apart, this is serious talk. You know, this is a question which we've been asking for ourselves. Why can't we get the people out? Even trust me today, while everything is well on the Indian front, not a single seafarer is under captivity. As we speak, 30 seafarers of different nationalities are still in captivity. One is probably the longest saga going back captivity, four people, to February 2010. You can just imagine, it is 5 years and 2 months. I won't name the nationality, but those unfortunate people are still stuck there. Governments have
tried.
The fundamental thing is that there's no negotiation. There's no payment of ransom by the governments. Because the moment you do that, then the state is perceived as a weak player. And then you open yourself up to compromises. And that compromises can be extremely damaging. Not just once, it can have ripple effects time and again. So the government policy is that we shall not negotiate. We shall not pay a single rupee of ransom. Rest, everything that is possible is being done. The trouble with Somalia, as I said, is that why is it not happening in West Africa? People are getting released in 1 week to maximum of 1 month. Because you're dealing with a government. You can talk to the Nigerian government, is still fragile, but you can still talk to the Nigerian government, put pressure to the Nigerian Navy, and then they'll come to heel. But here is Somalia, as I said, the complexity of the challenge is so diverse and so complex that it is impossible because there is no one there to talk to. For example, these people who spent 4 years, it was a very unique case where they were captured on 28th of September 2010. The vessel Asphalt Venture was released along with 8 Indian seafarers. There were 15 Indian seafarers initially. The master and remaining 7 were released with the vessel on payment of 3.5 million ransom by the owner on 15th of April 2011. In an unprecedented first of a kind of action, the remaining 7 Indians were held back. The vessel went away. 8 colleagues went away, 8 crew members went away, the 7 were kept back in an expectation for payment of additional ransom. That happened for the first time. But the owner wrote it off. He threw his hands up saying, look, I have paid my part of the deal. I have given $3.5 million. It was meant for the release of my ship and all the 15. Bad luck, tough luck, if the remaining 7, I'm in no position to pay more. And then it became the baby of the government of India between April 11 till November 2014. 3.5 years went on with this international. But the only positive I can say is that, yes, indeed, it is very arduous. The ordeal is unbearable, for sure. But there is very little we can do because other governments similarly placed are also not able to make a breakthrough. Because you can't go into Somalia. There's no one to talk to. And they are held in territories which are dominated by Al-Shabaab. What do you do? Except for launching a physical attack. And in a physical attack, you don't know what the outcome will be. If you decide to rescue them, if you launch an armed attack, for all you know, all these hostages could perish. So that's a calculated risk. No government worth its salt. It's possible to do it. But then the backlash from the families, the media, and the entire country will be so crippling that you can't. Because anything can go wrong in that moment, in a split second, when an operation is launched for it. So you have to play the cat and mouse game and persuade and hopefully There are international donors, NGOs who then pay the amounts, and that, but that takes a lot of negotiation.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. My name is Basil Joy. I'm from BTEC third year. So I just, you are telling about Citadel, means you are mentioning about in your lecture. I just want to know that, means I read in an article that in modern ships, the Citadel is so equipped that once pirates board the ship, the entire crew can get in and the ship can be navigated from inside the Citadel. Means I just want to know whether it is possible or is there any ship equipped with this facility or is a project still working?
It is possible. It's not a fantasy proposition. It is very much in existence. That's why the citizens are designed to be a module which is autonomous, which can navigate the ship. The master has his own another command and control structure. It's like another bridge which operates. Adequate provisioning, medicines, water, arms, minimum arms are available. So then for 3-4 days you can do a voyage. That's exactly, it's a replication of that. It's a mirror image of the bridge. Otherwise no purpose is served.
Secondary bridge.
Yeah. I think there's someone else to speak. It's here, it's here.
Sir, I am Captain Shatanik Bhattacharya, BSc first year. Sir, as you said that there is privatization of the Navy in a conventional form, sir, will there be any floating assets in that part other than armed personnel boarding the ship?
Could you please repeat that for clarity?
Sir, floating assets like, will there be any battleship belonging to any private Navy?
No, first of all, let's be very clear conceptually that navies are all state-owned. Navies, as we understand traditionally, unless you're talking of a merchant navy. And merchant navy is certainly not the war navy. So there can be no navy which is privatized. Necessarily, per force, it has to be an extent, it's a part of the state arm. It's a government-owned asset. It's a military asset. So there's no question there. Private players, yes, they are providing armed security escort. They're providing you armed security guards. There are these floating armories. They are backup essentially for the merchant marine to take a call whether they want to go in for that or not. Some of them would prefer to only avail the benefit of armed convoy escorts of navies. They're happy with that. But those who wish to avail that, it's a free world at the end of the day. You can take a choice.
And sir, another thing. The crew member, along with the persons who are boarding, we cannot understand that what they can do. As you said, that they can go trigger happy at any time. The armed personnel who are boarding the ship. So, sir, the better alternative will be if the crew can be trained for it, sir.
Oh, that's the last thing that should happen, because if you have trigger-happy armed guards, you can have trigger-happy crew as well. So, I don't think it's a good proposition to equip the merchant navy with arms and ammunition. It's always better to have professionals whose line of business is primarily to deal with security component. Have them. In fact, we had recommended, we have been pushing for either the CISF or retired Indian naval personnel to be trained with a marine leg to go on board as commandos, because they bring that specialized skill. They've been in the Navy past or they have been in the CISF. So that is what we would encourage. I don't think it's a workable proposition and a good idea at all to have seafarers to be trained and equipped with arms. You can have a potential mayhem, and it's a recipe for chaos and disaster.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, if there are none, can we just go back to the last question? Okay, yeah. You see, the point is the privatization of the maritime education sector began in the year 1997, historically, if you go back in time. Until then, it used to be completely state or government controlled. 97 onwards, when it was opened up, there was a phase in which it was literally there for the asking of any entity who came forward for an approval or a license. Under the STCW convention and the MS, Merchant Shipping STCW rules, DG Shipping is the ultimate arbiter or regulator for training, as we understand, with reference to certificates of competency and certificates of proficiency. as we speak today, 134 maritime institutions are approved by DG Shipping, 84 for pre-sea and about 50 odd for post-sea courses and modular courses. There are a whole set of players who are outside this 134 who do not wish to be part of DG, and unfortunately the rules and the Merchant Shipping Act do not provide any penal provisions or any deterrent power to the DG to bar them from operating. There, for example, there are certain players who are running maritime courses approved by foreign maritime administrations, Australia, New Zealand, UK and the like. They don't come under our ken. So we say that as long as you are our approved, we put the list on the website. Now we are doing a gradation, the CIP, Comprehensive Inspection Program, in which both pre-sea and post-sea institutes are actually assessed, graded A1, A, B1, B, etc. on different parameters, including provision of shipboard training and even subsequent employment. What we are doing is we are educating, sensitizing the prospective students and their parents so that they can take an informed choice whether they, he or she should put their ward in that, in this profession at all. If yes, to which institution, because then it's all there in the public domain. You can see which institution is doing well consistently over a period of time and then take a call. So you don't need to mindlessly rush into a program which is being done by an institute which has not taken care of its own boys. Now, what is being done, what is the question that what is the government, what are the government institutions doing to provide you employment? You see, what happened is that when the boom period went on, there was a demand for seafarers. So liberally, maritime institutions, my colleague Captain Gopal will correct me if I'm wrong, liberally in the early 2000, approvals were granted to a number of institutions, new programs were permitted, increase in capacity was allowed, but suddenly came 2008 when the financial sector meltdown took place and then there was a reverse gear movement for the shipping industry. For some time it went unhindered, but then we came in at 2011 and 12, we said no, this, you need to close the tap. No new approvals, there's a complete ban now on new institutions. We do not allow unless it is government institutions and set up only in the northeastern states or in Lakshadweep or Andaman Nicobar, because those are special category cases. Other than that, no new institution is being permitted. Then no new programs are being allowed even by existing institutions. No increase in capacity is being permitted. So there's an absolute freeze on all that. And the question is whether you want to take the next harsh step and say you de-recognize this institution. It's easy to say that. There are litigation challenges which we have to face. Somebody has invested, and I'm saying I'm not advocating anybody here. I'm playing the devil's advocate. Somebody has invested, let's say, a couple of crores. You ask him to shut his institution. We would wish it to happen. But we will be then encountering a serious litigation challenge in the court of law that how do you do it. So what we are effectively doing is by grading an institution, by putting it in the public domain, sensitizing the prospective students and their parents, in a manner of speaking, we are discouraging those institutions which are the laggards to be treated that way, and so that they die a natural death over a period of time. If people do not come up to them, in any case they will find. Today you will find that a lot of private institutions who are not doing well, they're coming to us and say, look, please freeze our capacity. We don't get adequate boys. We're not able to run this program. Freeze it for us so that if you want to revive it at a later stage, please allow us to come back. Or they're saying, please convert it into from DNS to BSc Nautical. We are happily doing that. Because at the end of the BSc Nautical, you're still getting a degree. You want to move away from maritime, get into some other sector. By all means, please go ahead. There is also a clamor now for reverse engineering, if I may use the word, where somebody wants to convert from DNS to GP rating and vice versa. So we're looking at that as well. So the point is that we have ensured that the tap is closed. We are not permitting anything. There's an absolute ban as we go along for the last 3 years. CCMC catering courses have been put a full stop. GP rating the course is banned since about 2004 or 5, 2002. So it's a good 13 years that we have taken this conscious decision. The rest of the private players who do not meet up, do not come up to the requisite standards, will get impacted on their own whether you like it or not. And incidentally, there is a program which is right now being run for cadets of 2010-11-12 batch. It's a centrally funded scheme. This is, of course, right now it's only confined to these three where for shipboard training, there's a grant come financial sector assistance scheme which is right now rolled out. We have a few boys who have just joined in for the orientation course in Mumbai. The details of which are available with you, I mean, they're available on the website, but that's limited, so I'm not sure whether that'll be there eventually. But I think a prudent institution will be one which encourages and promotes and ensures that there is shipboard training for the cadets. And also, employment finally is what you are capable of. No government can guarantee you an employment. Please understand, it's a free market economy. You have to work your way through demand and supply situation. But I can assure you that just as in management schools, in IITs and good institutions, where there are, where boys go on internships for a couple of months, they do internships. If they prove their worth, that is converted from a PPO, a pre-placement offer, to a final job. Believe me, a good employer, and if you prove it during your sea training, if you get a seaboard training, if you prove yourself, a good employer worth his salt in his right senses would want to take you finally. He will give you an open offer. Please come back because I'm looking for good guys. Why would he not? So the ball is in your court. You prove your mettle, both in terms of competency and integrity, that you're worthy of that employment. Do I assume that there are no more questions, or we can apply the guillotine? Well, there are two ways to look at philosophically. One is that nobody's understood anything, or perhaps all is well that ends well, I guess. Anyway, if there are none, thank you so much, and you've been a delightful audience. Thank you so much for your patient and attentive hearing. It's been great being here. Thank you.
Jay Kannan.